this Sunday. It's good to see all of you here. The Presbyterian Church is a member of the Ohio Council of Churches, and all of us are sitting today. Churches are remembering our call to fight racism and bigotry. And we are doing that today, and we are celebrating that with other Christians in our state. And you'll hear that theme throughout our service this morning. But as we gather ours together, we remember that we are first of all and above all children of God, the followers of Jesus of Nazareth. And we come here so that we can go stronger and deeper in our faith, and then go back into the world and serve it, because God loves it. In a world that is fractured and divided and at war, we do our very best to support and care for another, regardless of our differences. Things like our ages, our races, our sexual orientations, and gender identities, because we truly believe that in Jesus Christ, we all stand on equal ground. And as you will hear later today, we follow Jesus in his earthly ministry of compassion and through the pursuit of justice. We do our very best to follow Christ's example. And so I tell you, this is the household of God. We are the body of Christ gathered in this place, and we are all welcome. Join me now in a moment of silence as we remember people around the world who are at war, whose lives have been torn apart, and yet we come and to celebrate and give thanks to God for God's grace and God's goodness. So let us be in prayer.
Thank you.
And so we come, O Lord, to acknowledge this truth that lives in our hearts. God, help us to hear today the living word that you will speak as the scriptures are read and proclaimed, as we celebrate Anti-Racism Sunday in Ohio. God, help us to hear your still small voice and then go back into the world you so love and live it. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, he who came preaching reconciliation. And together we say, Amen. You may be seated.
Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Trusting in his promise, let us in silence call to mind the burdens of regret and remorse we carry. Creator God, in your wisdom, you created all that is and declared that it is good. Forgive us when we treat badly what you create and love. We harm the earth, the sky, the seas. We disrespect all manner of people created in your image and consider them inferior and unworthy. Help us to humble ourselves and turn to your ways of mercy, justice, and peace through the saving power of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. God sent Jesus into the world not to condemn the world, but to heal, redeem, and save it. Be assured that God is for us, not against us. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free to begin again. Amen. Our first lesson is in Ephesians chapter 2, 17 to 22. In a few Bible, it's page 193. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints, also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God.
Thank you.
to us from Matthew's Gospel, the 15th chapter. Then Pharisees and scribes came to Jesus from Jerusalem and said to him, "Why do your disciples break all the traditions of the elders? For they do not wash their hands before they eat." Jesus answered them, "And why do you break the commandments of God for the sake of your traditions? For God said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die. But you say that whatever tells father or mother, whatever support you may have given them, it must be given to God instead. Then that person does not honor father and mother. So for the sake of your traditions, you void the word of God. You are hypocrites." And Isaiah prophesied rightly about you when he said, "Those people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines." Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Now listen and understand. It is not what goes into your mouth that defiles you, but rather it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." And then the disciples approached him and said, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what he said?" Jesus answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Leave them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Lord, explain this parable to us." And Jesus said, "You still do not understand. Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands, this does not defile you." The Gospel of Christ, and may his name be praised. And now, by the power of God's Holy Spirit present with us and among us and inside us, may my words become a living and helpful word in your ears. Amen. Well, I think it's safe to say that most of us do not like to be around super critical people. When I see one of them coming, I try to run in the opposite direction. Anybody else do that? They rarely have anything positive to say. They're fault finders and nitpickers. They love to find mistakes and point them out. They argue and challenge the most innocent statements. And they tend to be very cynical, finding all kinds of malevolent motives and dubious intent. Would you not agree they're exhausting? They just suck the joy right out of life. The one thing, though, that they either do not see or refuse to acknowledge is, number one, their own imperfections. Number two, their shadow self, that part of them that is full of malevolence and evil intent. And you know why? Because they project it on the rest of us. They project their low self-esteem, their inadequacies, their own self-loathing. It shows up in other people especially in the sorts of people that they think are just somehow qualitatively inferior, people that they think are somehow beneath them. Which brings me to Matthew 15. And there we have yet another gaggle of naysaying, fault-finding Pharisees. So very religious and scrupulous. And they had Jesus on their shadowy radar screens. They were part of a movement within Judaism at that time that was convinced that part of the reason such bad times had fallen on the people was because of their general inattention to the details of their religion. Namely, all those hundreds and thousands of commandments given by Moses that are in the first five books of our Bibles, but also thousands of rules and regulations in what is now called the oral tradition, the interpretations of the great rabbis and the theologians of that day. Two-thirds of that oral teaching, not the Bible, but the oral teaching, Jesus is talking about that in the lesson. When he talked about the traditions of the elders, two-thirds of it had to do with food. What they could eat, what they could not eat, how it had to be prepared and served, and how they were to wash up. And this is what got Jesus all honked off at. Because the Pharisees were noticing, actually they were probably really looking for something, but they were noticing that Jesus' disciples, well, they weren't following all those rules about hand washing. They just pulled up a chair and dug in, which technically made them unclean. And to their way of thinking, dirty hands pointed to an unsanitary heart and soul. So these hypercritical Pharisees, they followed the letter of the law, especially when it came to the practical and the protocol, the ritual of their religion. And they assumed that Jesus and his disciples, well, they were just thumbing their nose at God. And to them, it was just evidence that Jesus was not a prophet and he was not a true teacher, a genuine rabbi. So they brought this to his attention. Why do your disciples not follow the rules? You are the boss. And Jesus probably explained to them, you know, they're simple farmers and fishermen and day laborers. Can't even read, much less remember all those details that concern you. But here's what they are doing. They are falling in love with the God they had not known. This God who had always loved them, despite their smelly bodies and their dirty fingernails. Jesus was teaching his followers to pay strict attention to things that matter more. Such as forgiving a person who had harmed them, letting go of grudges and resentment, attending to the needs of their neighbors, and oh yes, not judging and criticizing everyone for every little thing. Remember that story, all that stuff about splinters and eyeballs compared to moths? It's the same thing. He was telling his critiquers to stop projecting all of their ugliness and their meanness and their low self-esteem on him and his followers. If they really want to snuff out uncleanness, he said, why don't you attend to yourself? Look in the mirror and pay attention to what is in your own hearts. What comes up out of your mouth rather than what's going into it. Because that, he said, is what really makes a person unclean. It's a matter of one's heart. I really do believe that Jesus was a first rate psychoanalyst before there even was such a thing. He understood the human psyche and how quick we are to find and locate inferiority and imperfection and wrongdoing in others so that we can sort of ignore it in ourselves. It makes us feel just a little more superior, just a little less, faultless. Jesus saw it, but his critics either could not or he just wouldn't. Bring this forward. I think that this is a big component of racism and other forms of bigotry. Putting others down in an effort to make ourselves feel just a little less inferior. I'll never forget a conversation I had one afternoon way back in the mid-90s. The little church I was serving was hosting a small gathering of Church Women United. I don't know if that organization still exists, but it was going back then. 2 hours before this meeting was supposed to start, I was in the church building and in walked this absolutely elegant, well-coiffed, elderly black woman. I greeted her. I didn't know what else to do, so I thought, well, we'll just start getting acquainted. So we spent an hour or so talking. She asked about my life, and I asked about hers. Her life had been generously seasoned by hardships, and those evil barriers of racism and white supremacy. But she pushed through it because of her Christian faith. It was her Christian faith that told her that she, no matter what anybody else said, she was God's beloved child. And her beautiful black skin bore God's image and likeness. Her great-grandmother was born into slavery on a plantation in Virginia. But 100 or so years later, she was the first person in her family to graduate from college. She came to Cleveland and taught grammar and English in the Cleveland Public Schools. But the thing that took my breath away was that she herself owned up to this projection business, to the imperfection in her own heart. We were talking about prejudice and bigotry and racism and how it just belittles and dehumanizes people. And I told her I just couldn't understand how people, especially Christians, could think this way about other people. How they could be so mean and hateful, especially white Christians. And then she taught me a lesson on projection. She said, Pastor, most people, regardless of their skin color, find someone to look down on. She said that way we don't have to look at the own ugliness in our hearts. But yes, some people do it more than others. People find someone to look down on. She owned it. And she helped me to own it in my own heart. My own well-hidden racism and judgments. My own ridiculous sense of superiority that caused and frankly still causes me to, shame to say it, look down on certain people. Paul, the former Pharisee, he saw this in himself. He looked down on his fellow Israelites who didn't meet his high standards of the law. And he had all kinds of contempt for Gentiles, for non-Jews. But then he met the risen Christ in a mystical experience on the road to Damascus, and he flipped his self-righteous life end over end. And he spent the rest of his life preaching the good news of the God who created all people. All people as equals, even Gentiles. Because he came to understand that God is much more concerned about the conditions of our hearts than what we eat or drink, or if we're clean freaks. Paul said, you know, it's just a big, hairy human mess. This nasty business of finding someone to look down on and then make the call for one reason or another that they are unclean, inferior, maybe even unrighteous and undeserving of God's grace and kindness. But then he also said that identifying it and eradicating it in human hearts is now a huge piece of Christian ministry and faith formation. Paul went on to call it the ministry of reconciliation, bringing people together rather than pulling them apart based on differences. I'm glad to say that we took that seriously here at OMC a couple of years ago when our leaders made the decision to join the Matthew 25 movement within the Presbyterian Church USA. We pledged with thousands of other congregations to love and to care for our neighbors. And one piece of that is owning up to racism and bigotry and all of its ugly, evil manifestations in ourselves, in our churches, in our communities, in our nation, and in the world. I want to invite Matthew and Cindy now to go to the lectern. And they're going to share with us an update on our ministry of reconciliation, especially when it comes to these issues of racism and bigotry. So,
to recognize this day, the Ohio Council of Churches has called to be observed as Anti-Racism Sunday, October 15th, 2023. And as a Matthew 25 congregation called to dismantle structural racism, we are taking the opportunity to reflect on what we have done in the recent past to address racism in our church and our communities, and then consider what steps we will take moving forward. Today we will identify actions our congregation has taken in the recent past. We apologize for any omissions, and we appreciate being informed of those unintentional oversights so they may be added to our list.
As the list of actions are read, if you participated in that group or offering or offered prayers for those events, will you please stand and remain standing? We acknowledge there are people who took part in some of these activities that aren't here today. They're either other places on earth or some up in heaven. But we'll count them all with us in spirit today. Again, please stand for any activity in which you participated and remain standing until our list is completed. So, the Women's Small Group Book Study, Waking Up White, by Debbie Irvin. That's where I met some of you, Gail. Yeah. And Jean, I know you were there. Women's Group participating in the Racial Wealth Gap Activity Simulation. Presbyterian Online Book Study, Me and White Supremacy, How to Recognize Your Privilege, Combat Racism, and Change the World. Oh yeah, Debbie, you were in that first group too.
If you attended and or utilized the Presbyterian's Race Action Network meetings, such as a presentation by Jane Elliott, or review materials on their website, please stand. If you participated in the John Knox-led Presbyterian-wide book study, Uncomfortable Conversations with Black Men by Emmanuel Apacho, please stand. Or if you offered a book study with Grace Presbyterian Church on the book Cast by Isabel Wilkerson.
None of you participated in Cast, right? See anybody? The Small Group Book Study, Anxious to Talk About It, Helping White Christians Talk Faithfully About Racism by Carolyn Halsall. Developed and offered a Lenten series on the Belhar Confession. Nobody participated in that. Hosted a post-conference presentation by Presbytery staff on White Privilege Conference. Film, some of you also remember, viewed films and discussions offered by the Matthew 25 Task Force here.
If you provided a space and began serving as a fiscal agent for the newly organized Lakewood Black Caucus, or if you helped participate in hosting the anti-racism classes for church and community members led by the Lakewood Black Caucus, please stand. If you hosted one of the Presbytery book studies on Jesus and the Disinherited by Howard Thurman, these were all facilitated by LPC members, please stand.
So LPC as a congregation, as an organization, is supporting the Lakewood Black Caucus, which hosted a Juneteenth celebration. We offer, and those of you who offer donations of clothing and supplies for persons who are homeless and financially in need through Lakewood Community Services, Metanoia, the Presbytery Homeless Network, Haven Home, and the U.S. Committee on Refugees and Immigrants. And contributing to the PCU, and many of you contribute to the PCUSA special offerings near Easter, the 1 week hour of sharing, which is part in part provides support for the Presbytery Synod and National Self-Development of People grants, which began over 50 years ago.
If you helped prepare and provide meals for Metanoia, which was November to mid-April, approximately four times a month for 50 to 40 people, please stand. And finally, if you organized an offering of letters for your Bread for the World, please stand.
You're welcome,
Madison.
Thank you for your presentation.
So you can see, as we all know, racism still exists. So what will we do going forward? One thing that we must do, that will be required of us, is for our session to develop our own anti-racism policy, and our session will be working on that this spring. There are always more books to read and study and digest. Perhaps seek out opportunities for genuine learning and opportunities, such as those offered through the Racial Equity Buddies program that was mentioned in the October newsletter. Personally or in groups, utilize Jane Elliott's commitment to combat racism. Research books for a book group in the church library, which addresses anti-racism. Review Drowned Town reports on the Race Action Network website. Research additional Drowned Towns and share with congregation and presbytery about them. Talk about how all we seem to come together with other area congregations to identify more opportunities to engage in this ministry of reconciliation. And finally, what I'd like you to do now, if you have an idea, use one of those index cards that are in the pew racks in front of you, and just write that idea down if you have one. If you don't right now, but think about it. If you do, write it down, and then you can slip it in the offering plate during the offertory, and then we'll get it to our leaders. I want to thank Cindy and Abraham and all of you who've taken such a great leadership and initiative for us to get serious about caring for our neighbors and about this ministry of reconciliation. Very proud of all of you and what you've done and what we can do.
God of life, in your honor.
Gracious God, we give you thanks for your commandments. Commandments which order our life together. The command to love you above all else and to love our neighbors. God, we remember before you those who are at odds with one another. Especially today, our hearts are just heavy, oh God, for what is going on in Israel and Palestine. Lord, show us what we can do to bring comfort. We pray, O Lord, that leaders will find a way for peace. That those who kill and destroy and terrorize will be found and brought to justice. So that both Israelis and Palestinians can live their lives in peace, with justice, and with the means for life of meaning. Holy God, we remember before you our loved ones, our church members, who stand in need of your healing, your touch. Especially today, we pray for Grace and Bill and Matt and Laura, Reverend Bill, Jim and Barbara, and others whose needs and circumstances are upon our hearts. God, touch and heal them by your grace, and help us to be instruments and agents of your healing love. Gracious God, we pray for the power of your Holy Spirit to continue to guide us in our own ministry of reconciliation, to join with thousands of other Presbyterians as we commit to caring for our neighbors, to owning up to racism and bigotry, and doing our best to stamp it out, bringing people together rather than pulling them apart. Gracious God, hear our prayers and answer them by your grace and mercy. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, he who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit, rest upon us this day and upon the world that God has made and continues to love and redeem.